right, so seven times on this drawing, I've said that we have heaters. So now we're gonna do a deep dive into the heaters. Thank you for your assistance. All right. So you got a heater, and on one end of it is what we call a water box, and you've got condensate or feed water flowing in. Condensate or feed water flowing out. And then you got bypass around it. Then from the inlet water box to the outlet water box, you've got a tube sheet. And then you've got 16,000 tubes. I made up that number. Bunch. It is a bunch. What's the point of all those tubes?
Surface
area. So we're trying to heat the water. So by having surface area, more surface area, that's more chance for the heat on the outside, the shell side, to conduct its way into the water itself. That is correct. All right. So then, going into the heater, we have steam. Where are we getting the steam from?
Extractions.
So it is extracting the steam off of the turbine from some intermediate stage. So the steam goes through several sets of blades, it expands, it gives up heat, it gives up energy, and now we are borrowing some of that steam to come and put it on the heater. And then the water comes in, goes in the tubes, the water gets heated up by the steam cools down, and the steam condenses and forms water at the bottom. And then that water keeps filling up, and goes all the way, and now we're stuck. How do we get rid of the water?
Drains.
Where's the drain to? Incorrect. Well, hold on. If we're talking about heater 1A or 1B, that is correct. Most of the drains do not drain to the drain cooler in any kind of direct sense.
It goes back to the... Was that a condenser?
All right, that is less wrong. Hot well condenser are synonymous for the purpose of this discussion. So there are two drains. There is a normal drain and there is an alternate or emergency drain. The emergency drain is going to the condenser. The normal drain is not. Jackie, bail them out.
Go to the heater before that one. The drain to the door heater. Next heater.
It's a cascading drain.
Okay.
So if this is heater 7, then this drain is going down to heater 6. Let's see. There's also this funny little thing here. Let's see, there's like a, I guess this needs to be a separate color. You can't use blue for the water and the. So there is like a box here. So this section of pipes right next to the water box have the coldest water in the heater, right? And so then, before this water can get to the drain, it has this little section that has baffles in it to make the water take some time in this section to get it as cool as it can before we go to the next heater. Why is that? Efficiency.
Yeah. Because your heater below is going to be a less.
A less hotter than the heater below.
Yeah, so the way you measure the efficiency of this heater, how close you're doing to getting as much energy out of the steam as you can, is we compare the temperatures of the cold water going in from the condensator feed water and the drain water coming out. And if those were the same temperature, then you would know that this feed water is cooling that down as far as you possibly can. You're getting every bit of energy you can out of that steam with given the inlet temperature you got working for you. Now, usually this temperature is more like 8 degrees, and that is acceptable, but this approach temperature, how close you can get the drains to the inlet, is a way how you measure the efficiency of the heater.
So that's water, but it's still hot water. So even the water, but the water that's still coming in is still cooler than that water. So that even that water is going to make a transfer of heat in that well.
Right. All right. Let's get some actual numbers on here. Yesterday I asked about the temperature on the feed water or the condensate at the pumps, and we guessed 120, and I said that was probably a little high. The book says 110. That actually sounds a little low to me, but maybe I've been off the board a long time, so I don't know. And then we go to, is it Lansing with Sauce Consumer? So according to this, we've got 110.3 here and 110.4 at the outlet of the glance steam exhaust condenser. So there's not a large volume of steam in the glance steam exhaust condenser. It is low pressure steam. We're talking 4 pounds. So there's not a lot of energy to be gained there. Glance steam exhaust condenser is not really about efficiency. It is about creating a vacuum and a way to get rid of that glance steam. So then the drain cooler, we are now at 124. And then 1A and 1B, we're at 190. So heater 2. Why are there two numbers? Oh, that's enthalpy. All right. 330, 315, 360. I called that 350 earlier.
I mean, that's usually the number you get when you're taking the
pressure.
Now you get an inboard temperature too, though, right? That's great.
I have not done those rounds ever. There was some paper version of those rounds that I did 8, 9, 10 years ago, and I cannot tell you how much of those made it to what you're. The current version. So I cannot tell you what is and is not on the rounds unless it's something that you guys put out of spec and it turns red and draws my attention to it and then I remember for a while. But I don't have the familiarity with what you're actually looking at on the rounds the way you guys do. So then after heater 5, we're up to 410, 487, 523. So now I'm going to ask, what's the boiling point of water?
212
at atmospheric pressure, right? So even though this water is 239, 315, 360 degrees, it's still water because it's under enough pressure. to keep it water. So you spitting out the answer you're used to and realizing it's a trap halfway through. That was all right. All right.
Thought we were going to break out all those books. Steve David.
I think. Going.
Green. I'm going with green for. All right.
Do you know the number that comes out of the car monitor?
No. Is it on here?
I don't know. I thought maybe that was one can't memorize.
No, that's the boiler. Car monitor is not on my drawing, so I cannot. It's another 50 degrees or so. I don't know. So we have extraction steam coming off the turbine, going into heater 7. And then heater 7 has a normal drain that's going down to heater 6. And it has an emergency drain that's going to the hot well. And then, so this steam, do I got a number for that?
That's enthalpy. So 900 degrees, no, 900 pounds, 530 degrees. So 900 pounds, 530 degrees, and then that water goes into here, or that steam goes in here, and then the feed water comes in at 487, and the 487 is taking energy out of that steam and collapsing it down into water. And most of that energy is not actually in terms of degrees change, it's in terms of collapsing the steam. That phase change is where most of the energy is tied up. And then we cool that 530 degree water down to, I said we had a 10 degree approach, so 497 degrees. And then that is cascading down into heater 6. So heater 6 is only at 625 pounds instead of 900 pounds. At 625 pounds, that 497 degrees is below boil or above the boiling point. So it will immediately flash to steam when it comes in there. So we've got another extraction. Ooh, this one comes off over heat. So you've got another place you're grabbing steam that's going to heater 6. And then you also have the drains from heater 7, which go into heater 6 and flashes to steam. And then the water going through heater 6 condenses it, cools it down, turns it to water. You got a normal drain going to heater 5. You got an alternate drain going to the hot well. And you got another extraction off the IP turbine. That goes into heater 5, and then heater 5 has an emergency drain going to the hot well, and it has a normal drain going where? That was a random piece of equipment to grab off my drawing there. Heater 5 is normal drain is going to heater 4. The DA, correct.
That's what I was thinking. That's why I didn't shout it out.
I think it goes into the DA directly. I was about to run the base switch. All right, so you're having these thoughts. You're like, how the hell is it draining from the second floor to the fifth floor? That doesn't work. And the answer is steam pressure. So the steam pressure coming off the turbine, back to my cheat sheet, is 283 pounds going into that heater, and then the DA is only at 150 pounds. So that gives it 130 pounds of ass to push it up 5 stories. The DA is different. This is a direct contact heater. The steam coming off the turbine is directly mixing in with the condensate water and becoming part of the flow. There is still an emergency drain, except we typically end up calling it the high-level dump. DA storage tank. If for some reason this level that's normally at 100 gets above 110, this dump valve starts coming open on its own and automatic to try and protect you from that 136 trip. Normally it stays shut unless we're in a shutdown, and then when we're circulating the condensate system, we open this valve up so that the water goes up to the DA and comes back to the hot well. Just gives it a place to go, lets everything aerate out and get chemicals added and mixed up. Goodness. All right. Heater 3 has an extraction coming off of the LP. Heater 3 has two drains. It has an emergency drain going to the condenser, to the hot well. It has a normal drain that's going down heater 2. Heater 2 has two extractions going into it. No one has given me an adequate explanation as to why it has two and all the others have one. But it does, and it is.
Selling more pipe.
I cannot refute you. All right, then heater 2 has an emergency drain that's going to the hot well, and has a normal drain that is not going into 1A and 1B. Where is it going instead? The flash tank. Where is the flash tank, Terry? What are we talking about?
I know where it's down on the first floor, one of the next to the condenser.
Are you thinking about the miscellaneous drain tanks?
North side, second floor.
Yes. So second floor, north side of the condenser, is kind of halfway down between the deck when you're walking around over, but when you're going to from, you're going around the isophase. You're going behind the isophase over the turbine where the breaker is. There is a tank that is halfway down through the deck.
Yeah,
we put it, fill it up. Yeah, alright, fill it up. So coming off the flash tank, there's a loop seal that goes all the way down from the second floor to below the deck on the first floor. Ah, I should have gone the other way with that.
Foot
12 inch
pipe,
that thing is going to
be empty.
We're going to
check it, fill it up.
I'm going to see the way it checks. All right. So then the flash tank has a. And this taps him off the top. Yeah, that's better. And the flash tank has a normal drain. That normal drain is going to the drain cooler. Counterflow. On that side, coming out. On that side. And then where are we finally going?
Condenser.
Back to the hot well. And then there is a level control valve there. So this level control valve looks like it's come off the drain cooler, because it is, but it is not controlling level in the drain cooler. The drain cooler is full. It is controlling level in the flash tank. Where is that valve? Flash tank level control. Going into the hot well.
West side
of the hot well. West side of the hot well.
West side, I've got rocks going through it all the time.
Yeah, the green, yep.
That is correct. So those rocks are the water from the flash tank being too hot compared to the water in the condenser, or the vacuum of the condenser. And so that is, when it gets past this valve, that's, that water flashes into steam, and that's making noise. If they turn off some cooling tower fans so that the circuit water runs a little hotter and you got less vacuum in there, it pops less. One A and one B. These drains combine and then go into the same drain that the flash tank is using to go into the same drain for, as the flash tank, going into the drain cooler and into the condenser.
Is that hot enough to start with?
So this valve that is controlling the level in the flash tank is kind of also controlling the level in 1A and 1B, which is to say that 1A and 1B should be empty. Because if you look at where the flash tank is, it's kind of halfway through the deck.
Mm-hmm.
And if you look at where 1A and 1B is, you kind of got to go up a two-foot ladder to get to them. So that these heaters should always be empty because the gravity should equalize the level of the flash tank, which is, say, below the level of the heater. On a high flash tank level, the emergency drain is actually this overflow through the loop seal and into the condenser. Once it starts flowing that way, it's going to keep on doing it. Once you wash out that loop seal, it's going to keep on flowing. Everything that goes in the flash tank is going to flash into steam and immediately go over to the hot well. You're going to lose some efficiency, you're going to fuck up your back pressure a little bit. It's not that bad. To fix that, there's a manual valve you have to shut here, and then you have to refill your loop seal, which is coming off the demon header. One A and one B are tapping extractions off the LP turbines. Because they're in the condenser, there is no check valve and there is no MOV. The steam is going straight from the condenser into heater 1A and into heater 1B. That means a high level in heater 1A or 1B trips the turbine. And because it trips the turbine, you've got sensors in triplicate. We've got a cascading drain, we've got an emergency drain, we've got an extraction coming off the turbine and going into the heater. We may have a cascading drain from an upstream heater. Heater 7 doesn't, heater 3 doesn't. But right here, 1A, 1B don't. But 2, 5, and 6 do. There you go. Look at me doing math.
That's in case you got one heater out of service.
Yeah, so this cascading drain, just because. So we go from heater 7 to heater 6 to heater 5. Heater 7 does not have a cascading drain going into it, it's at the top of the line. Heater 5 goes to the DA, but the DA doesn't go to heater 3. It's separate. It's a different kind of heater. So there's no cascading drain going into 3. And then 3 goes to 2, and then 2 goes to the flash tank, And then one A and one B don't have any kind of cascading drain going to them, because two went to the flash tank, which can kind of skip the one A and one B because they are so touchy and dangerous and could trip the plant. Follow? All right. There are drains. Little air-operated drains going to the hot well on the turbine side and on the heater side of the extraction line, of the extraction MOV. The one on the heater side is so that if you have water actually build up, it has a way to go somewhere other than just sit there on the MOV. This check valve, the way it was explained to me, this check valve's job isn't really to stop water flow coming up. Because if you have water flow coming up, that cold water is probably going to warp the shit out of that valve anyway, and it's not going to do its job right. What this valve is for is in the event of a turbine trip, suddenly you're not putting steam in anymore. If the MOV doesn't go shut, does not shut like it's supposed to, you've got this water in here that we already said was 500 degrees. If you're not putting pressure on it anymore, 500 degree water is going to start boiling. And so you're going to have steam going backwards, and that's what the non-return valve is there to protect from. It's from that steam pushing backwards. Which the way they sell it could overspeed the turbine, because this is a turbine trip scenario, right? What normally slows the turbine down is that big fucking magnet on the end. The generator's trips, the magnet turns off. So there's nothing to slow it down, and if you still have steam going to it, it's gonna overspeed. It's gonna. All right, instrumentation. We've got a sight glass. We've got a level switch. And we've got, oh, no, but that's at the top. My bad. Got a level transmitter. I'm having trouble with my LTs looking like fours. Yes, but I don't think, it's not something I meant to talk about. And I don't think it is on this part. I know you have a pressure transmitter that comes off here. I don't know if you have one that's actually on the shell side or not. I can't picture it, but that doesn't mean that it's not there. All right. These sight glasses, how do they work?
Magnets.
So there's a magnet in there that floats on the water level, and then there is a whole bunch of little flips that are black on one side and red on the other side that have a magnet on. And so that magnet floats down, it's going to catch, and it's going to turn them so that they go from the red side to the black side. As it floats up, it flips them from the black to the red. Which is a hell of a lot easier to see than the little glass bulbs that get kind of foggy, and you're like, is that a level? And then you're shining a flashlight from either side, trying, and then you're kind of shaking it a little and going, is that a level? Is it empty? I can't tell. And then you're like, okay, check on your little rounds box, because what else are you going to do? So these are a big step up. So you have two level switch. You only have one sight glass. You got two level switches and two level transmitters. Remember all that talk we had about three transmitters and triplicate and median select? That doesn't apply here. that this equipment is not worth the trouble. This, if one heater trips, we are supposed to still be able to make full load. We lose efficiency, but we are still available for full load. So it was not worth putting the third transmitter on all these different heaters and adding all this extra logic, and they did it the easy way. So you have an A and a B, and it averages A and B together. And if they're both reading 11 inches, and all of a sudden alpha flakes out and reads 80 inches, then the level control valve goes, oh my God, you got 35 inches in there. And it opens up and drains all the water you got in there out. And because it's a cascading drain, all that water goes down to heater 6 or heater N minus 1. And then that level valve is going to go, whoa, where'd all this water come from? It's going to have to pinch off and then open up, and it starts swinging all your damn cascading drains when this happens. And then the control room operator looks and goes, 35 inches. And they go, oh, but level switch didn't kick in. And then they hit the hand station and they say, oh, well, one says 11 and one says 70. I'll just pick 11. And they select A instead of average. B, I had an A flag. They select B instead of average. And all of a sudden it goes back to 11. And this valve that was wide open trying to get rid of this 35 inches that wouldn't move goes, oh, it's only 11. And then things settle back up. That is a scenario that used to happen a lot, especially because heater 7, these level transmitters did not like this 550 degree steam. They did not get along well with it. All right. So we've got this protection for our turbine. And we just discussed that the level transmitter makes the thing swing all around, but it didn't trip the heater. The level switches trip the heater. And it doesn't take both of them. Either one trips the heater because you want to be conservative. One could get stuck. You don't want the one that's stuck to keep you from protecting your turbine, right? So something goes wrong and the cascading valve, drain valve fails shut, and this water level starts coming up, and this level switch goes, oh, I got a level. What does it do to protect the turbine? You're correct. So, well, hold on. So the cascading drain, in the scenario I just admitted where it failed shut, what should have happened is this level goes up about an inch, and then the emergency drain goes, hey, cascading normal drain is not doing its job, and it starts coming open, and then it catches it before we get to the trip set point. That would be a better scenario. What they're really worried about is these tubes busting leaks and putting more water in there than the drain can handle. You get in that scenario, and the water level's coming up, and the level switch sees it. Now, what do we do to protect the turbine?
Close the bottom valve, open up the top valve, then open up the bottom valve.
Okay, so we start out with the inlet and outlet both open, the bypass shut, extraction open. So we are going to shut the extraction because what we're trying to do is protect the turbine, right? This non-return valve has a little air assist cylinder on it too. That guy's also going to take the air off and let the thing sag, and that'll go shut. We're going to go open with the bypass, and we're going to go shut on the inlet and outlet. If you're a control room operator and you're sitting here and you try and go shut on the inlet and outlet and the bypass isn't open, it's not going to let you. It's going to say, hey dude, you need that water to keep going to the drum. Don't fuck up.
You gotta have somewhere before it's good.
But if this level switch says that it has a high level, it does not wait for the bypass to open. It immediately starts sending these shut and the bypass open at the same time. It's also going to open these two little guys. It is also going to shut the cascading drain because we don't want to put any water in there. So the upstream heater is going to go to the hot well instead. Its emergency drain is going to come open. It does not actually affect these drains. They're both going to stay in auto and do their job and try and get rid of the water. All right. So this is Turbine Water Induction Protection, TWIP. So there is a TWIP test that we can do. And the way that works is you go, well, first you got a good communication with the control room. You got to be on the right level switch. You say, hey, it's December. It's an even month. We're going to be doing the Bravo level switches. So that's going to be in the brief. Everybody's going to be on Bravo all the time. Or say Bravo a lot on the radio during this process. Make sure you don't fuck up. So then you're going to tell the control room, I'm going to be doing the test on the Bravo level switch on heater 6. And you'll say, okay, heater 6, Bravo, selected for test. Go ahead and manipulate your switch. So then you are going to shut the top valve. And then there is a vent that's going to a funnel. I think double isolation probably. And you're going to open that vent, and that is going to let the water come up and hit that level switch. And then the float in there is going to close the circuit, and then the circuit is going to go tell the logic, hey, I see my level switch, and it's going to go, yeah, but I know that we're testing that switch because the control room operator put it in test mode first. And so then all these valves that are supposed to move are going to move a little bit to make sure they work. So the extraction valve is going to go from 100 down to 90. And the same things on the inlet and outlet. And the bypass is going to come open to 10 to make sure all those aren't stuck and they all respond in auto. Cascading drain is going to go shut. And the emergency drain on the upstream heater is going to go to the hot water. And these guys are going to go open. These guys aren't going to allow it to go shut until they see a full open on the extraction. And that is a TWIP test.
How often is that done?
I don't know.
I mean, I've never been involved in it or even heard it.
All right, so we kind of do it when we're going into a planned outage.
Okay.
That there is debate as to how often we are supposed to do it. It used to be done monthly. But when you were doing the DA storage tank, there's three level selectors to switch. There's an A, a B, a C. Alpha, Bravo, Charlie, if you're speaking phonetically. And if you say you're testing Charlie, but you're actually on Bravo, and you line up the vent and let the water come up, and it gives a real high level, it can trip the fucking plant. Because it did. On my crew. On the second day that NRG was in charge, and when I was a supervisor for only 3 months prior to that. That was fun.
Who was it?
Robert Rogers. Yeah, Robert Rogers was the guy actually manipulating the valve. And, you know all these nice pretty tags we have out here that have descriptions on them? The description on the valve, the valve tag said Charlie transmitter. But it was lined up to Bravo transmitter. The valve number was right, but the description that got pulled out of MP2 by whoever was, Tim Duncan, who was doing all the engraving and hanging the tags, said Bravo, or it said Charlie, but went to Bravo. So that is, whose fault is that? Mine. Because I was in charge of the whole fucking mess, and it happened. Is it? So if you want to point fingers, you can go, oh, well, whoever set up the MP2, but put all that information for all the equipment in MP2, all 1,500 equipment items, probably more than that, in MP2.
Wow.
So, yeah, 15. So somebody at Black and Beach, it's their fault. Or you can say that the guy who's turning the valve could have followed it and seen that it wasn't going to Charlie. He could have looked at where the pipe was going. Or you could say that I shouldn't have been in the damn control room. I should have been out there putting my eyes on the actual equipment instead of being over Daniel Hill's shoulder. Where am I most useful? I don't know. It totally depends, and it's hard to make the call every time right.
At least you'll know what happened. There was no
investigation, and it's like, well, this would happen.
Oh yeah. And like I said, NRG had been our bosses for like 3 days or something, and Don Sabotic was on site, and he came up to the control room and said, what happened is the plant's like all tripped. And I'm like, hold on, Delta crew, come to the control room. And so then I have a big fucking debrief about what happened. And before it went, Danny Sharp was in there on the engineering station watching, and he's like, they're on the wrong valve. I see movement on Bravo. They're on the wrong valve. They're on the wrong valve. And then Daniel is like, back off. You're on the wrong valve. Psh! So. So because the DA storage tank high level is a plant trip, the rules are different. Instead of bypassing heater 3, the inlet and outlet go shut, but the bypass stays shut. It doesn't come open because you're trying to stop putting water in there. What good does it do on the bypass if you're trying to stop putting water in there, right? And when you're doing the flash tank, when you're doing the level switches on it, heater 1A, 1B, and the drain cooler, all those respond at once. Because that's because of how it's piped in. Man, I think that's it. All right, any questions on our deep dive into heaters and drains and TWIP tests and turbine protection? All right, thanks for your time.